have the remarkable Alina Paris, who is a Senior Vice President and Chief Information Officer at ChampionX. Alina has more than 25 years of experience in global information technology leadership roles across various industries. She received a bachelor's degree in industrial engineering from Northeastern University, a master's degree in technology policy management from Boston University, and she didn't stop there, and she got a doctorate in information technology management from the University of Phoenix. Alina, you are one in a million life and career journey types of stories, and we're so excited for everyone to finally get to hear your story. We talked to you maybe over a year and a half ago, and so the fact that we can finally do your podcast is really amazing because you're such an inspirational woman that I think a lot of people will look up to once they get to know even more of your story. And also, chief information officers, there's not a lot of women in it. So the fact that you are leading that and just being an inspiration for everyone is really amazing. So thank you for being on the podcast today.
But thank you. You make me blush, but I appreciate that. I'm very excited, and the work you do, guys, is amazing. So I'm happy to be here.
Thank you so much. And we have to go back to when we first met. And it was so interesting because at that time, we actually heard a lot about the Soviet Union and Ukraine. And it was surprising when we learned that you were actually from there, born and raised into really a situation that was always kind of warlike and where we're kind of dealing with today. I feel like our listeners are all going to be like, oh, I definitely know where Ukraine now is on the map. And maybe before they didn't. We'd really like to understand, what was it like living there during that time? And what was your childhood like? Because especially in the United States, when we hear about these countries that are war stricken and there's like things that go on there that we're not very used to in the US, it's always the images is all we see is what's, you know, online or on the news. It'd be really great to just understand from your perspective, what was that like? And when you were able to come to the United States with asylum, how was that different from that when you were living in Ukraine? And what was that feeling like when you were finally in a country where maybe you actually had some freedom?
Well, thank you. I'll be very happy to share. So post-World War II, when my parents were growing up, the war period had actually stopped. And so by the time I was born, in a generation significantly post-World War II. The childhood, my early years, wasn't much different, believe it or not. I was growing up during a relatively peaceful period, no wars. And just like I look at my children when they were growing up here, you know, I was on the swim team, I was in elementary school, I spent summers in summer camps, I was taking ice skating lessons. So for a very long period of time, as I was growing up as a child, you know, I went to daycare, my parents worked. Very similar in many ways. It is when I entered early teenage years, I began to really understand the political environment, the challenges that parents and people were facing in the Soviet Union. So that's when I really began to develop awareness. And it was different from the peaceful, blissful childhood that we led. And once you begin to understand that, you enter your rebellious teenage years, all of a sudden the awareness, the acceptance, the alignment with what's around you changes. And I was in the teenage years, my parents' concern was with that awareness and rebellious among all the teenagers and doing things that speaking up, not necessarily following the norms, they were scared for their children. And then part of that, leaving the Soviet Union, seeking political asylum, certainly getting to freedom and opportunities, but in many ways, very pragmatic, protecting their children from entering a danger zone. But from the childhood perspective, I have very good, great parents. I was on the swim team. My objectives were to get to Olympics, and you know, summers were great. So I couldn't really see that difficulties until I entered the teenage years. And that's when we decided, my parents decided it was time to seek a better life, just like many generations ago. And before we got to the United States, we went through a very interesting experience. We left Soviet Union as a political refugees. We spent time in Europe with other millions of refugees and in Austria and Italy, and finally a community in Western Massachusetts outside of Boston had accepted us as part of a group of the political refugees that landed in the United States via New York City and then in Worcester, Massachusetts, which is 35 miles west of Boston. And I ended up there in a small community, and that's where I resumed my life as a teenager in high school.
Wow, Alina, I think just what rehearing it again, it just brings back so many memories on even just your childhood. And to your point, such a good childhood. And I think your parents were really good at maybe trying to show their kids that everything's great. And I think a lot of parents try to do that and just try to provide the best childhood, even though maybe deep down they were worried about maybe this is going to come back, et cetera. So they did a great job at making your childhood, you know, flawless. And to your point in the teenage years, which is really what shapes you a lot when you become an adult, is when it gets a little bit difficult. And to your point, you moved to the US after kind of going to Europe, et cetera. That must have impacted you even in who you are today, of just moving, restarting from zero. You mentioned your parents had to leave everything behind and start from scratch, get new jobs, new professions maybe. And can you tell us a little bit about just what that was like coming to a new culture? You didn't speak perfect English, getting into your point of like feeling included in a new country with different people. Tell us a little bit about just that time when you arrived.
So my parents, just stepping a little back, my parents were both engineers and they spent their professional lives working as engineers, as engineering managers in various industries. I had a younger brother, so when we left, he was just a baby. And then we had my grandmothers, one on each side, who were already in their late 70s that came along with us. So it was a bigger family than just me and my parents. My parents had. And so when we came to the United States, obviously, it was caring for me, my brother, and my grandmothers, and then entering a country without understanding anything. So it's before internet, before what we take today for granted. You know very little, and also the Soviet Union behind the Iron Curtain, very little information was flowing in. So you're entering a culture, a country, an environment where you know very little about, plus obviously the language limitations for all of us. So my parents had to really come into this country and take jobs and opportunities that were maybe not what they used to be doing. And so it's now looking back as an adult to what they had to accept was very, you know, it's very, you know, for me, I'm admiring them, but also see the difficulty of what they went through. So my dad at the time stepped back from the engineering opportunity and applied his skills from earlier days and became a machinist in the one of the companies, so which didn't require a lot of the language skills, very proficient. My mom, who was an industrial engineer or economist, stepped back and worked in a factory. She assembled things that was, and then ultimately through the years, she learned the language, obtained additional education, and she spent most of her career until retirement in the insurance industry. But those early years were very difficult for them psychologically, you know, financially, maybe not as much because we got a lot of support as refugees do for basic needs. Me going into high school was in a small town, which I considered small after a big capital of Ukraine, going into small Western Massachusetts town, completely different culture of high school, not understanding the language, not understanding how this high school worked. I would even offer a funny anecdote from there. As I was picking up the language and I felt more and more comfortable, I was sitting in my biology class that first year and I'm like, oh my God, I don't understand what these girls are saying. And they were speaking Greek. They were Greek immigrants. I couldn't even tell. I was upset at myself that I wasn't picking up the language. But so early year, that first year, and especially we landed in the middle of winter in Massachusetts, it was difficult. But as time went on, I think the resiliency of my parents, having my brother, having my grandmothers, slowly understanding the community and picking up language, I think, the second year, and as we learned the environment, it became easier for sure. And as the summer came and the snow melted.
I really want to talk about, like, what I think is so interesting is when I hear your story and I'm just listening to you talk about even being a rebellious teenager and hearing what you went through with your parents. And then when Maciel introduced you, she went through this long list of degrees that you ended up achieving. However, when you were in high school, you really wanted to leave high school and pursue a college degree and not really go on a very traditional path. And you even got married at 19. And so when I look back at Alina, when she first started, it's like, did you think that you could ever get to where you were today in the position and role that you're in? And what was your mindset at that time? Because I'm thinking about even being at home with your parents and them going through this really difficult time and having to transition, having to understand the language, having to figure out what you're going to do. How did you keep that strong mindset to continue going on? And more importantly, what do you think pushed you to do that?
Well, thank you. So I think part of that rebellion, you kind of channel into different areas. So if I were in my old setting or somewhere, I would have channeled it and probably something else. But being in the situation that we were, the rebellion kind of translated into, well, I didn't like this high school, I didn't like this environment, and I was a decent, I was a good student back, in the former Soviet Union. I picked up the language relatively quickly, enough of that language. So my rebellion kind of channeled into, well, this is the situation I don't like, so what are my options? And because the education systems were different, even though I came and I was only in 10th grade, I had enough background to seek opportunities to get out of high school. I guess I just didn't want to stay there. So luckily, there were a lot of good supportive people even then. And they shared with me, the counselors in high school, that, yeah, you can apply to the university as an early admission, but you have to take this test. So my rebellion, my focus kind of pointed to, well, let's try that. And so math is math. It may be in English, but math is math. And it was my strong point. So I said, so what test do I need to take? It was SAT. Well, I got the book and I started looking at it. Well, that's not that difficult. Equations and formulas. And, I had to rearrange my brain because the long division is done differently. These things are done differently. But for the most part, I mean, it was not that, difficult to understand what the multiple choice test is and math. And so the English part was more challenging. Luckily, somebody advised me that as a newcomer to the United States, I could take TOEFL, which was the English for foreign students. And so that is more adaptable to how, to students who learn English for the first time. So I took my test. I did well. They told me how to take them. And then I applied at Northeastern that had the early admission program. And they said, well, we can take you after 11th grade without the degree, but you have to take physics 101 during the summer and you can't get anything below B, just to prove that you can be a freshman. And I think I spent summer taking physics. I got whatever I got, B or A, and off I was to college. And my first number one requirement, not only did I want to leave high school, I wanted to live on campus. I wanted to live in a dorm. I wanted to submerge into what my future may be. And you can call it assimilation, you can call it immersion, but that's what I did. A lot of my friends who immigrated or who came to the United States chose to stay at home. I chose to jump with both feet, and I moved to Boston and lived in a dorm. And many of my dorm mates changed my name to Ali because Alina seemed to be more complicated for them. And there I was, my first year living on campus in Boston and studying in a college of engineering.
Wow. Just every part of your story is just really incredible, because I would say a lot of people may have these ambitions of like, oh, maybe I want to leave, but they don't act. And the fact that you're like, I need to do this, I need to do this, I need to do this, this looks hard, I don't care, I have to do it in the summer. But it's almost like you have a goal and you'll do whatever it takes to get to it, no matter how challenging it could be or kind of the extra work that you have to do. And also, I would say just the fact that you want to get out of your comfort zone and go in a dorm with probably a lot of Americans or just people who are going to change your name, and you embrace that side. And I think that's really what it takes to be successful. And even as your career progresses, it seems you keep doing that. You know, when you graduated, you worked at AT&T for about 7-ish years. I would assume it's also a pretty male-dominated industry, kind of like that information side or tech side of the world. Can you tell us a little bit about early on when you graduate, you know, you go into the quote-unquote real world and you're now in a corporate setting. How did that prepare you, or how did you prepare yourself? Because I would say without having parents who were in the corporate world in the U.S. who know how things work, or you've got a network, how did you handle those first, let's say, 7 years where maybe a lot of people say, this isn't for me, and then they leave that industry?
So thank you for asking. So one of the great things about the university that I chose, Northeastern University in Boston, and I knew that up front, they had, you know, today we have internship programs. What Northeastern had was a co-op program starting with a freshman year. So you could not graduate, you could not get your degree unless you spent, we had no summer vacations. We had to alternate co-op experience with our studies at the university. So immediately after my freshman year, I got my first co-op job. I had to interview just like you have to interview for internships. And I ended up at Honeywell. And so I spent alternating quarters or semesters throughout my college career working for Honeywell. And that was one of the best things, just like for interns today. When you graduate, if you don't have an internship experience, you're kind of disadvantaged from others. So by the time I got my degree, I already had multiple semesters of working in the corporate environment at Honeywell and in technology spaces. So it really, really helped me. As I entered AT&T, it wasn't an unfamiliar environment. I already was familiar how companies work, what engineers do. So I held different, same company, Honeywell, but different jobs throughout my internship, co-ops through 4 years. So when I entered AT&T, it was a fascinating experience because the company, it's a flagship. If you learn about divestitures and mergers and spinoffs, AT&T emerged from a Bell System divestiture at that time. So it was quite interesting. But I jumped right into manufacturing engineering. And your comment about male-dominated industry, and especially manufacturing, where you manufacture telecommunications equipment. I started at one of their largest plants in Massachusetts, which had about 10,000 employees, big research Bell Labs, very famous research department. And then when I walked in my first day and that first week, I remember it vividly. It was before casual Fridays or casual Mondays or casual anything. You had a building of engineers that was about 2 miles long with cubes. You could stay at one side and look, see the end of that cube country. And almost every engineer, except for a few of us new hires who were women, there were a few of us hired at that time, were men. They all wear white shirts and dark ties. And within a week, they all knew who we were, but they all looked the same to us. So it was an interesting experience just going through that. But at that time, I wasn't looking at it as an obstacle, you know, and then just in everything. It was a great opportunity to enter such an iconic company in such a, you know, it's electronics manufacturing, it's telecom manufacturing. I thought of it as more as an amazing opportunity. And I spent the first 2 years, 3 years really working in manufacturing, learn a lot. It's kind of followed me through all my career, learning about manufacturing, working in manufacturing as an engineer. But very quickly, I learned that I have passion for technology. So even within those 7 years, I saw change. So after 3 years, I switched from manufacturing into information technology, into supporting our manufacturing from systems. And that kind of laid down the foundation of my career. But I never looked at it as an obstacle. And I think that's the difference. I think sometimes we tend to create obstacles for ourselves, and we need to look at challenges as opportunities, not as obstacles. So
I'm just envisioning this cubicle like sea of men and like how difficult it would be. And what makes me think is at that time, you know, there wasn't the policies that they're in place today or this big push for diversity. And so do you feel that there was certain like men that were like your sponsors or your mentors when you first started to really kind of also boost like your confidence in what you were doing? Or do you feel that you kind of had that already and they noticed it and that's why you were able to prosper in such a large organization? Because AT&T, as you said, like it had tons of mergers and acquisitions. It became a very big company and some people can get lost in that. How were you able to continue to stand out?
Yeah. So I think they didn't have anything when I was sort of growing up in my professional career. We didn't really have mentors as we do today. And I mean, I love volunteering and being mentored to younger professionals, but I think there was a lot of support. And I think just the history of the company and focus on skills and technology and knowledge really helped. So there was a lot of, I would say, mutual respect of what you brought to the table and what they taught you and what they supported you in. So there were a lot of great people, both where I worked, but across the whole company. And just formal education and training as a professional was amazing in my early years. You know, I think in some ways we do it today, but we don't do it to the extent that some of these companies maybe did for younger professionals in the beginning, but a lot of support from other engineers, managers, co-workers. And even at that time, I would say AT&T was very progressive with a lot of employee resource groups, not so much mentors, but employee. We had what we call WAT, Women of AT&T, and, you know, other employee. We didn't call them employee resource group necessarily. So a lot of networking for a global company, and combined together, it was really an opportunity to learn and develop and, you know, support very much for post undergraduate education, formal programs of all kinds that enabled you to network and, you know, really develop those professional and collaboration skills.
So question, when you left AT&T, what was the next opportunity or what made you leave after 7 years for...
So I didn't leave AT&T after 7 years. My career at AT&T spanned a number of years in States. Oh. You know, so I transitioned, but I saw change. I moved from manufacturing engineer to information technologies. My husband, so I left him. I missed mentioning him along the way. We got married when I was a sophomore in college, and he was an engineer as well. So, he ultimately joined AT&T as well, and we were able to move to Columbus, Ohio, where he was at the beginning of wireless revolution, and I was able to join Bell Labs, which is a famous research organizations where I spent a number of years doing research and development, different from manufacturing, which also opened my eyes to many different things. We also moved to Naperville, Illinois, with AT&T that became Lucent Technologies, and then ultimately Alcatel-Lucent through mergers and acquisitions. So, I spent a number of different, assignments and states within a company that was originally AT&T, but became a slew of other companies, as we all know, through mergers and acquisitions. But taking different roles and ultimately growing in my career as the director of information technology was my last assignment there. And how did I leave? I was already in Naperville, Illinois, and I was managing a global infrastructure environment, all the global data centers for Lucent, Alcatel-Lucent at that time. And one of my previous managers reached out and said, there is this great company and great opportunity that just went public, and would you like to join them? And would you like at least to go and meet people there? And I never thought that I would do that, but just something, you know, it's a change, it's an opportunity, and I happened not to go on an interview first, but just went in to meet with a team and talk to them and had lunch with, and I just loved it. I mean, I think one of the things that I do, and if you speak to us, I don't just make decisions. I go a lot on, you know, quantitative, you know, measures and information, but also part of it is my intuition and my sense that that's, you know, it's a great match. It's a great opportunity, great team. And leaving that day without yet formal interviews, I was convinced that this is an opportunity to make a change and, you know, join a different company, join a different team. And ultimately I did. And I just never looked back. It was great. Mm-hmm.
I guess it's that saying, if you know, you know, you know, like, you know. So actually talking about all of the kind of your journey through even one company with mergers and acquisitions, when you went over to Nalco, et cetera, that also had its fair, you know, mergers, et cetera. How does, you know, with being through all of that and really focusing on culture, which is something you really value, and you've experienced many company cultures kind of all coming together, what do you think is the most critical thing companies can do to instill a positive and inclusive culture when that is happening? Because you've been through so many already. You know, ChampionX seems to have done a really excellent job, even when we spoke with Soma and just Kristen and so many other people in the organization, where culture really does seem to be the core of everything you guys do. You know, can you tell us a little bit about just how you've evolved or strengthening your culture, even though you guys just became a standalone company about 4 years ago?
Yeah. So I'll start from when I moved to Houston and helped to stand up ChampionX. And I think because it's really, Soma embeds that into words. What I couldn't put into words through all my experience, he seems to be able to put it into words, what I felt and what I thought through all my experiences. First and foremost, cultures are created by people. And when you move from company to company, you look and you feel and you listen to what the values are within the company. And most of them have something historic, something new, just like when you get married, right? You know, it's just something old, something new. And I think, but everything has a unique touch or sense. And I think it's important, as engineers or as technology people, we always look for precision or for numbers or for something, but we have to step back and like feel what the environment brings, what's important, what's valued. And I think Soma was able to put it into words when, being humble and being curious is what is at the center of what I felt at ChampionX. And also improving lives, I'm like, what does that mean? Like, we all want improving lives, but it really, you know, he was able to translate it to all of us, and we really made it integral to how we feel every day at work. We make it better for our coworkers. We make it better for our customers. So through quality work, through timely delivery, through putting integrity in what we do every day, and also being active in our communities, being respectful to our coworkers, to our customers, to our suppliers. And I think that kind of centers what that culture is. And I don't think it's any different at many other companies. He just was able to translate it into some specific words that resonated with me.
I think it's so important is about the people, because like Marcel mentioned, we've met so many others from ChampionX, and they all have this like this personality about them, or the way that they even answer calls or talk to you or talk with you, or it's just that you can get that ultimate connection. And I really do think that culture is evolved by also who you hire and who you bring in. And I think y'all have done such a great job attracting that type of talent. You know, right now in the world, we talk a lot about AI, which is an ever-evolving thing. I think, you know, when ChatGPT came about, it like scared everybody, but we can really see what AI can do in real life. And it's not just at the fingertips of big companies. Like, everyday people can go on and utilize this. You have been able to see the transition in technology throughout your entire career. And a lot of times what we have seen or what we hear is that a lot of people don't want to adapt or take that initial change with the next step in technology. They're scared of it. You've embraced it. I'd really like for you to share with us, with all these changes, how are you able to continue to thrive and like how do you continue to learn about these things as they're ever evolving? Because there's really, even with AI, there's still no answer. It's like this kind of this bucket of like, we're still trying to figure out how do we utilize it and how do we utilize it for the good of what it can do. What have you experienced so far with y'all's AI capabilities and just being a part of that community?
Yeah. So thank you. So I have to say, being in technology, when I found technology, I have a lot of passion for technology. But I would have to say, being close to it, being using it, leveraging for business, for education, I felt like from the, internet, when internet was popularized and available to the masses until now, until like 2 years ago when AI came on the scene, most of the changes were incremental. Sure, I mean, they were big, but for most part, incremental and not super exciting. So if you're passionate about technology, that, step back a year and a half or 2 years like me, when it came on the scene, and I have to admit, I studied AI in school. I didn't find it super exciting at all. I still, for those people who listen to this podcast and remember Lisp, which is the first AI language, I mean, it was boring, but I think what changed a year and a half ago, and I am part of what I love about technology is democratization of tools and technologies and just opportunities for people to use. And my role as a CIO, I want secure tools, technologies people can use to bring value to customers and other employees. So when this AI burst on the scene, that it's more democratized, available to everyone, I mean, to me, it was like a fourth, fifth industrial revolution, But to your question, it's frightening and it's exciting. And most of all, for many people, not necessarily having understanding of what it can do. So part of embracing it is really gaining that deep understanding and not so much about the detail level of technology, but application of it to the real world. And also including risks and including benefits. But the next big step is educating others. And I found that last year and a half, me and my peers spend a lot of time both learning from all kinds of sources, but also spending time educating employees in our company. And as a matter of fact, this is our development month, and I'm doing some of the classes for virtual employees, and we call it AI 102 because we did AI 101 last year, but we invited speakers and we did internal ones and just really letting people understand and learn about AI, because one center point that we try to explain is that AI is a tool for people who know what their field of expertise. It's not me implementing AI and it's different from automation, different from everything else. So if you're a chemist, once you understand what AI can do, you can apply to your real problems. And that's how we deliver or present in our education and given the tools. So I think that's very important, because once you understand what it can do, then you can apply to the problem you're expert in. And that's probably the biggest thing. And also outside of ChampionX, just meeting multiple experts and knowledgeable people, spending time with industry professionals, academics, really makes you much more effective in then bringing it back to your own environment.
Yeah, I think what you mentioned about just educating people and how they can use it is really important, because I would say a lot of the messaging that I hear is they're going to replace us. We're going to be, AI is going to replace all of us. So I think there's just that fear. So I think when you educate it properly of like, you can use this and make your job easier and better and even grow, I think really like the messaging. And I think once people really get to understand it a little bit, even through like 101s or 102s, it's more comfortable and then they want to embrace it versus this big scary thing.
And the other thing that we did, some industries are further out than other industries. So we brought a lot of examples from medical field, pharmaceuticals, to let's say chemical, because they're very similar. And once people, you can see it in their eyes, once they grasp it, they can immediately see where they can apply it, And yeah. So that was the big, that's how I approached it anyways.
Gotcha. So a few questions here. Just, you are, you know, the CIO. There's not a lot of women in these roles, even in CTO roles or in technology, let's say, or information. What do you think, or, you know, why do you think we're struggling on that side? I feel like, you know, we're struggling on all sides, but there's a lot more women in other types of roles. It's, you know, when you see a CIO or a CTO, it's like, wow, the unicorn, you know? So what do you think, or what can we do to encourage more women to go into that space if they're passionate about technology?
So a few answers. So first of all, when I was studying for my doctorate, my advisor said, you know, you have to pick a theme for your dissertation and your research because it's going to take 2 or 3 years. You have to be passionate about. So at first I was going to do something about mergers and acquisition and something. And, you know, it wasn't fun. It was kind of boring. And then I was at one of the, I don't even remember what it was, but it was some kind of, you know, one of the community colleges had a forum, and they were complaining that fewer and fewer women enter the field of information technology. And it resonated with me because the pool, I mean, you grow into your roles, taking different roles, but you still need to have that background and experience at various levels to be skilled, and you going through experiences of learning and understanding. And when I listened to it, I said, that's what I want to study. I did an extensive research of why women stay in technology roles and why they don't. Actually, I was going to say why they leave, but my advisor said, you don't want to study why they leave. You want to study why they stay. It's a positive intent. And so it opened my eyes quite a bit when I interviewed hundreds of women in technology roles at various levels. And to your point, very few CIOs along the way. But one of the, there are multiple reasons why you don't have a large pool of women in information technology going all the way to maybe leadership level. It starts very early. It starts at the high school level. Are they interested in that kind of field? Are they encouraged to stay? There are technology cliques among the boys and young males, and women not necessarily always part of it. And then when they enter actually professional world, why don't those who stay, what I learned through my research, are really encouraged to stay and want to stay because they see the outcome of what they do. So it's a little different in technology than, let's say, in medical sciences. You know, you're looking for cure, you're looking for, you know, all kinds of real outcomes. They need to see the value of what they do and impact on the company, impact on the community. And once they see it and are able to make that impact and grow through their roles, then you have a larger pool. I do have to say that there is a larger community today than early on in my career, and I'm fortunate to be part of the virtual community of women in technologists who are in leadership position, in CTO and CIO, in security officers. So it's growing, and I found that support and exchange of ideas support part of why you stay and why you continue to pursue, but we need to expand it.
Yeah, when you just talking about that, it really resonated with me when you said like the boys have a clique, and I can almost envision that even in high school years where you have like your groups and then you have like the guys who are like really into technology or engineering, and there's not very gaming is huge. You're right. We are seeing actually more women involved in gaming. I do see them, especially with like all of the social media things they can do. I feel like that has really opened and broadened the perspective of women to be able to have the opportunity. But gaming, yes, that's a huge part of just even using that side of your brain and like the things that you do. So to close the podcast, I want to really push on this just a little bit more because Champion X purpose is focused on improving lives. And you were just speaking about how it's important to start at the younger years because that's where you really figure out what you want to do, but also you get that support from the people around you. And you like to work in underserving communities and support those communities and IT related careers. So can you tell us, what can we continue to do and what have you seen be successful in getting more women in diverse groups into these technology related roles or even career based degrees?
Yeah. So I, both in living in Chicago area and then mostly when I moved to Minnesota and worked in Minnesota in information technology as a leader at my prior company at Ecolab, I got engaged with several organizations, but one of them, very active and actually was founded in Houston, Genesis Works, works with high school students in underserved communities. And they're by far not the only one, but it's just my experience. It really opened my eyes that in order to bring women and other minority students into technology, which improves long-term their economic lives and their prosperity of their families, we need to start early and we need to offer opportunities for hands-on experience at high school level because it makes such a huge difference. So I worked both in Minnesota, I served on their board, and when I came here, I was I'm a huge supporter, and we've been supporting a lot of the students. We started with two when I first moved to Houston, and we grew over time to several dozen working in various areas of technology. And that year is absolutely instrumental, that senior year, when we work with them and they're able to leave school early, come and work with us in the real corporate world, practicing, learning about technologies. They're the first ones entering college. They don't have to enter college. They can go into trades, but it makes a huge difference when you start early. And so given that time, and sometimes when we're in the roles of leadership to expand these programs, it goes both ways. It's so satisfying to managers who mentor these students, as well as long-term economic impact on the students and their families. It's just absolutely great.
I can't say enough about how much I love your story from the very beginning, just where you grew up and how you overcame such a really difficult time. I think it gives just so much perspective to our audience. And then just to anybody who might be going through something now, listening to how you were able to overcome it, come here with like not understanding the language to getting multiple degrees, getting into a role that is very profound in the energy industry, but not even starting in the energy industry to begin with, but finding your way here. We couldn't thank you enough for coming on and sharing your journey. It's been such a great time this morning listening to you. And I really hope that a lot of people get, you know, that understanding and that knowledge from this wonderful conversation and just the passion that you have for even the work that you do. So thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you. And you guys do an amazing job in Flipping in Barrels. I enjoy everything that you do for the energy industry here in Houston, but also beyond that. It's great. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Alina.
Thank you. And if you like this podcast, please like, subscribe, leave us a comment. We'd love to hear from you. And we'll catch you on the next one.